keeping the faith in the eighth. Let's make America great again. Honest. Result. My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed it, my brother. Prepare to die. On June 14th, 2017, a day that will live in infamy, around 6:30 in the morning, a man with a Soviet-styled SKS 7.62 assault rifle entered this park in the Delray section of Alexandria, Virginia. The weapon he was carrying weighs about 8 pounds, measures about 40 inches with a 20-inch barrel, and is most effective out to a range of 200 meters. He was an elderly Caucasian man over 60 and a Bernie Sanders supporter frustrated with politics, but no one stopped him. Reports say that he even asked questions to others in the park that day as to whether the gentlemen playing on the baseball field were Republicans or Democrats. Why would anyone arriving at a baseball field, even in a suburb of Washington, assume that people on that playing field are there because of their political affiliation? And not one alarm was sounded. Everything appeared to witnesses at the scene to be perfectly normal. No need for alarm. But when shots rang out, wounding critically Majority Whip Steve Scalise and wounding 5 others, officers from the Alexandria Police Department arrived within 3 minutes, by official reports, to contain the situation and kill the suspect. It was a day that shocked America and left all in horror and praying heartfelt prayers that our leaders wounded on not a field of battle, but a mere baseball field, would recover. Many questions remain as to how a person with such a large weapon of war might have been able to penetrate this safe space in a quiet Washington, D.C. suburb, especially one with a liberal ideology that is adamant about taking guns away. With such a strong rifle, one has to wonder why he chose to come to this place to engage at close range with a weapon where bullets struck the YMCA over a half mile away. A rational person performing a reconnaissance on this scene would have concluded that it was a suicide mission to begin with no way to cross the space between the street accesses to the park and to the playing fields where we remember the Titans play, where women with children walk with baby carriages, where children play basketball on the fields right next to the main street access, and where residents of Alexandria walk their dogs and let them run without a leash. But six national leaders were wounded by gunshot fire that day, and all available units were called from the Alexandria Police Department to restore order, arriving at the scene in just 3 minutes. Still, while it was a sad day, all could rejoice in some success. In the following days, celebrations of valorous service were recorded in ceremonies dispensing awards, while some maintained a partisan fervor, mocking a not-by president for extending his cheek to a female officer awardee to receive a kiss. Nonetheless, the president, the most pro-life president since Ronald Reagan, Donald Trump, commended all of the Alexandria police for their great courage, great service, and great sacrifices in the line of duty. That was then, but this is now. But on December 2nd, 2017, the Saturday before the first Sunday of Advent, just a half year after the events of that day, all available units at the Alexandria Police Department were again called into action, and facts suggest that they were alerted long before the criminal conduct was to occur. Four persons, two Caucasian women, a Caucasian man, and an African-American man, all of middle age and simply carrying red roses, somehow managed to breach the door and enter the foyer of a condominium commercial and residential property on Whiting Street, and all available units at a 9 a.m. roll call assembly were called into action again. A police officer not attending roll call, but having both a city-issued patrol car for personal use and a rent reduction agreement with that complex, was called into action immediately by the management team of an abortion mill. And after he put on his uniform, he was the first to arrive at the scene of the crime. A trespass in progress. At the trial of one of the criminal defendants, it was estimated by the officer in charge of the crime scene that he had absolutely no idea how many public safety resources were bankrupted to shut down this horrific crime of a trespass in progress. He offered just a ballpark figure of about 20 armed law enforcement officers plus emergency vehicles required to evacuate when one of the criminal defendants, who law enforcement officers claim to have failed to cooperate with arrest in her act of civil disobedience, requiring them to obtain a stretcher and roll her out rather than pushing her in a wheelchair with the others. Officers at the scene of the arrest even made mocking references to her weight, but all officers at court emphasized their own courteous behavior to the criminal defendants, and one arresting officer, soon to be assigned to the community desk, expressed great pride during his testimony that he even enjoys engaging in conversations all the time with persons he has just arrested while riding from the scene of the crime where they have received their Miranda rights. And he, with his officer in charge, confirmed that there are no standard operating procedures to avoid the potential of even accidentally violating the Fifth Amendment rights of persons who have just been arrested. After all, the testifying officer stated, if he knows that you are guilty, you have already waived your Miranda rights. Despite responding to a similarly horrific trespass in progress in September, despite calling out approximately 20 law enforcement officers, the officer in charge and the testifying officer confirmed that no officers involved in the prior apprehension were present at the scene in December. That the police department had no prepared plan for the dangerous act of a trespass in process or breaching the foyer door of a condominium with a red rose in hand. and that they basically handle the entire interdiction and apprehension by the seat of their pants. The officer in charge had no idea how many officers were under his care and command. How can he confirm that all officers returned from the scene without a proper head count performed at the beginning? How many shots were fired at this horrific criminal crime scene? Who can really say for sure? Were all of the dangerous trespassers in progress found laying on a floor in a peaceful civil disobedience position, identified and apprehended? Or might there still be somewhere on Whiting Street in a condominium tower responding officers who do not yet know that the situation has been contained? Or worse yet, the trespassers still may be laying on the floor. But dangerous criminals laying on the floor is always preferable to officers sworn to uphold the law just lying in court under oath. And today, one criminal defendant apprehended for the crime of trespass in progress actually prompted the Commonwealth Attorney to recommend a fine of $500, two times the fine of possession of marijuana, five times the fine of a transit worker caught jumping a turnstile who appears in court with her uniform. 20 times the fine assessed on a person urinating in public and appearing in public in a drunken condition, expressly stating as her rationale that the great inconvenience that he had caused the city by laying on a floor in civil disobedience in a liberal town that supports the killing of innocent babies because it is a woman's choice. It will be an interesting appeal to try before a jury of seven and to present a defense for crimes that they have done of an overriding and compelling necessity. See through a glass darkly, but then face to face. and I know in part, but then shall I know, even as also I am known. Happy New Year, and next year in Jerusalem. Keeping the faith in the eighth. Let's make America great again. Honest.
This advertisement was authorized by Mike Webb.